Hi, my name is Matthew Phelps, and I am the minister of music here at West End United Methodist Church. I think it is. It's not working? Okay. Well, I tell you what. We'll work on this problem in a second, and I will talk really loud.
Hello, my name is Matthew Phelps, and I am the minister of music at West End United Methodist Church. And I am very, very excited for this afternoon. This afternoon has been about 3 or 4 years in the making, because this organ recital is in memory of Carol Crow, who passed away 5 years ago. Seven years. Carol was actually on the committee
Is this working all right now? Okay. I love opening a concert with that piece, not only because it's one of my favorite pieces that wasn't originally written for organ, it was originally written for orchestra. It was the overture to the St. Paul Oratorio. And but also because this piece is so, so revolutionary when it comes to organ performance and organ building. Many of us are familiar with transcriptions of Lemaire from the 20th century, what's come to be known as sort of traditional orchestral organ transcriptions. But this is a little bit, this predates that a little bit. It's a 19th century transcription by William Thomas Best, who at the time was a very, very famous recitalist and organist, traveling around giving 300-some concerts a year, many in Australia. As you can imagine, it wasn't as easy to get to Australia as it is these days, back in the 19th century. But also kind of drawing a parallel, Mendelssohn was also a famous recitalist during his time. And even though he lived in Germany, he worked at the Thomaskirche in Leipzig, and you know, he had the famous German name, Felix Mendelssohn Bartholdy, he was actually more famous in England than he was in Germany. So when he published many of his organ works, they got published in England too, and he really catered to the English crowd in a lot of ways. Many of them were church musicians and needed voluntaries that were a little bit shorter. So every once in a while, you see a chorale thrown in there, usually a German chorale, a Lutheran chorale, that's like thrown into the woodwork of whatever piece that he's writing. And in this one, you hear the famous chorale, Wachet auf, which is Sleepers Wake. And it's an Advent hymn. But what was so interesting about Mendelssohn is that when he went to England, the organs were a lot smaller. They weren't like this instrument here with a big, large pedal board, lots and lots of manuals. They maybe had one, two manuals and smaller scale, you know, not as many notes. And the English organists wanted to hear Mendelssohn play so badly that he actually inspired some revolutionary organ building in England at the time. And it culminated in this instrument in 1841 by William Hill. That soon became so famous for being really big, more along the lines of this than along the lines of the traditional English instruments that were small and lovely, but still couldn't play huge, huge works. And interestingly, many of the works that they wanted to hear Mendelssohn play were Bach. Bach was very brought to the forefront by Mendelssohn. And since they had these huge organs in Germany that could play these extensive pedal parts, they wanted to hear this in England too. So it's kind of a representative piece, I think, that's really neat of organ building and how revolutionary it was in England at the time. The next couple of pieces I'll play are also not written for organ. They were written for pedal piano by Schumann. And so, as a result, we can have a little bit of fun with the registration. I'd like to play these two as a set. So the final piece I'll play of this sort of set of non-traditional transcriptions was a piece that wasn't even written for humans. This piece was written for a machine, in fact. The machine resided in the court of Count Duma and unfortunately is destroyed, though we do know that it was a musical clock. It took up an entire wall in the court, and it had some sounds very similar to organ sounds. We know probably that this piece was played every day around 2:30 p.m. At the same time, at least for a while, until they got sick of it. And we know that this piece was originally written on four staves. So many of us who are organists were used to reading off two or three staves. This was written for four and marvelously transcribed by Martin Hasselbach to the organ. I really like this piece to demonstrate lots of the beautiful softer sounds, especially on whatever instrument I'm playing. And this one has many luscious sounds and beautiful solo sounds that you'll hear in the middle during the Andante part. It is sandwiched between two louder fantasies and fugues. And at the end, I sort of like to think of it as a version of the first fugue, but it's like a wild second fugue. It's almost like the musical clock is kind of losing its mind and there are springs flying everywhere and wheels and things like that. So I think it's a pretty fun image to imagine what a ferocious piece this is.
Thank you.
The next piece is the first original work for organ that I'm going to play. It was written by a composer who died far, far too young, unfortunately, in a motorcycle accident. But he was a proud Frenchman. He was not only a prolific composer, but he was well versed in all things French. France really had a boom in organ building in the Baroque era, which is ironically come to be known as French Classic. Many wonderful instruments by builders such as Clicquot were built. And during the Revolution, it was the style to take things all church down. Some very smart organists, though, said, no, wait, we can play national music on these instruments. Listen. And they would play national music on the organs, and they saved some of these organs. So some of these organs survived the Revolution, and we have some of those sounds now, and we know what composers at the time were thinking of. And what I love about Alain's music is that it has this very 20th century twist on almost an old nostalgic version of this French classic type style. He calls for a lot of registrations, in other words, sounds that you hear on the organ that are reminiscent of that style. And not only that, but he displays the pride of France in doing that. In many of his pieces, you'll hear a few of these unique sounds called for, usually solo sounds. You'll hear like a solo line. And then he'll hearken back at the very end as if remembering something.
Thank you.
the next piece is written by an American composer who also died far too young. He wrote these five dances for organ that were premiered by David Higgs, and each of the five dances is in a different sort of mode or sort of harmonic language for the organ. So the first one is in a mode that was invented by 20th century composer Messiaen, the octatonic mode. And the second one is in a diatonic mode. So it's mostly very sweet to our ears, very familiar Western music. This piece is supposed to depict ballerinas dancing on point. You can hear the alternating hands playing one note at a time that's supposed to make that image. Thank you so much to West End United Methodist Church for having me here today. I attended your service this morning too, which was lovely, and it's been such a wonderful time to catch up with friends here in Nashville. It's a lovely city to visit, and I've had a blast playing this instrument and that instrument, as you can imagine. So thank you so much for having me here. The final piece I'll play is a Passacaglia. It's a form that Johann Sebastian Bach made very famous. But actually, in this case, it all goes back to Buxtehude. This piece is sort of taken inspiration from Bach's famous Passacaglia in C minor, which Mendelssohn made famous by playing it in many concerts. But what many people don't know is that Bach, as a young child, the way he used to get in trouble was he used to steal his older brother's Buxtehude manuscripts, and he used to copy them by candlelight in the cabinets. And I guess this is what kids did to rebel back in 1692 or however old he was back then. But he would copy these pieces because, as you can imagine, a photocopy machine was not so accessible back then, and it took a longer period of time, and he wanted to play them too. Buxtehude was a great inspiration to Bach, so much so that when he was working in Arnstadt, he traveled all the way to Lübeck, which was very far, I think 250 miles or so, to listen to Buxtehude, and he gave his employer, he let them know he was going to be gone 3 weeks to listen to Buxtehude. Apparently, he didn't return for 3 months, and he received a telegram from his church that said, if you don't get back here, you're fired. So he was back within the next week. But I guess he was just having a blast listening to Buxtehude. And perhaps one of the pieces that he would have heard is a Passacaglia in D minor, which sounds very, very similar to his Passacaglia in C minor that became so famous. So today, I'll play the bookends of a lovely piece by Rheinberger. He wrote 20 sonatas, most of which are 35 minutes plus in length. I'll play the introduction and the Passacaglia from Sonata 8.